Ice. This is where I grew up, just across the river. And you know, it's a funny thing about water ice, and I don't tell this anywhere, I can't tell this anywhere but here. Some of you know that I have a pretty active charity life back in Detroit. And I've been doing this for the last 20 years or so. And after a while, you get kind of tired of constantly asking people for money and please help us, and please help, and go to foundations, and please help. And I said to my friend Rosie at one point, who I grew up with here and who's here with me, I said, we should be able to sell something for charity. And, you know, wouldn't it be great if we could just sell something and then just take the profits and give it to the charity so we don't have to beg all the time? He said, yeah, and we went back and forth. I said, how about water ice? They don't have water ice here. Nobody has water ice here. And he said, yeah, that's a good idea. So a couple of years ago, we came back home here, and we went down, was it 70, 38? One of those. And we went to Primo's Water Ice. Some of you familiar with Primo? So the nice people from Primo's Water Ice, who just walked in. I never met them before in my life. And I went in, and I introduced myself. It's a mom-and-pop shop, literally. And I said, hey, have you guys ever considered doing anything for charity? And she said, well, it's so funny you say that, because last week I was in church and I was praying and asking for a sign about how we could do more in life. And I said, say no more. So long and short of it is that they ended up coming to Detroit. They ended up sharing all their recipes with us, all their technique, whatever. And I got Dan Gilbert, who owns Quicken Loans and half of Detroit now, to give us this little 1,000-square-foot shop right on Woodward Avenue, which is like the Broadway or Broad Street of Detroit. And in early August of this year, we opened the Detroit Water Ice Factory. And we have lines out the door because nobody in Detroit has ever heard of water ice. They honestly think we invented this stuff. So we put a big thing on our wall, what is water ice? And we made it, we said, it's better than ice cream because it doesn't have any fat, and it's better than this because it doesn't have any cholesterol, and it's better than this because it doesn't have any dairy, and it comes from a land far, far away, somewhere in a small, small town in Italy, you know, and they made it. And people are just dying over this stuff. And Rosie and I look at each other like, we get this on every corner in Philadelphia. But for some reason, it never got to the Midwest, so we have the first a water ice store in all of Michigan, and all of the profits, every dime that we make, we just put back into the charity Say Detroit to help our city. So we finally figured out the perfect product that can relieve some of the stress of fundraising. So if any of you are looking for that, the key is move to another town and then open up a water ice store, because this is the only place on earth that anybody knows what water ice is. People actually come in and say, so like, it's like a, what, like a glass of water and you put ice in it? Water? I said, no. So I'm glad that you're able to come out. I always like coming back home and talking. And it's particularly significant tonight because this book, Frankie, Presto, and this whole effort is really a lot about little things that happen and how people influence one another. At its core, that's what the story is about. Of course, this is the town where I grew up, just across the river in Haddon Township. And it's really where the genesis of this book and really my whole musical life began. I often say that I would not be in front of you, and I guarantee you that, if I had not been flipping the remote controls one night and happened to see Morrie Schwartz on television talking about what it was like to die from ALS, and then going to see him and ending up writing a book to pay his medical bills called Tuesdays with Morrie, and that turned into a whole other thing. Well, if I don't flip that remote control, if I don't take that airplane, none of this happens, right? Same thing, ultimately, with this book. I was living in a house in Haddon Township, and my uncle, who lived in New York, got a new piano and decided that he would get rid of his old piano. And he sent his old piano to us, living over in Cornwall Drive in Oak Lynn. And this new thing arrives in our house, this piano, and my older sister promptly gets piano lessons. And my younger brother promptly gets piano lessons. And for some reason, I don't get piano lessons. And of the three of us, I'm the only one who seems remotely interested in the piano. So I wandered downstairs to the piano, having never played it before. Probably like most of you, you know, I had my uncle showed me a couple things. And probably like most of you, if any of you play the piano, I sat down and the first thing I did was, see how this works. And then I graduated on to another song, a little harder. And as the years passed, I became interested in oldies music. This was a time, this was the early 70s, some of you may remember, where Sha Na Na and American Graffiti were very big. And it was like really the first time that anything was referred to as oldies music. Today, they refer to like stuff that came out in the year 2002 as oldies music. And I don't understand that. To me, oldies music will always have to be, you know, from the 50s or the 60s. And I happily discovered that this little chord progression is the basis of every single song written from 1955 to 1965. For example, you know the Bristol Stomp, right? It's written here in Philadelphia, right? Right. Right? In the Still of the Night. Same thing. So, I was taken to a school when I was 11 years old. I lived in New Jersey, decided to go. My parents sent me to a private school that was 40 miles away up in Lower Merion. And in order to get there on time, my dad had to drop me off and then get to work in Philadelphia. And in order to do that, he had to drop me at the school at 6:45 in the morning. This engendered some very interesting discussions in my house at about 5:30 in the morning when my dad would try to wake me up. And then he would drag me out of bed, put me into the bathroom. I'd shut the door in the bathroom. I'd turn on the water. I'd sit down and go back to sleep. Then I would hear him banging on the door saying, I know you're faking it in there. Nobody brushes his teeth that long, you know. And so then I would get to this school at 6:50 in the morning. Well, nobody's in school at 6:50 in the morning, right? And so we made a deal with the janitor to open the building next door to the school, and they let me stay in one room in the very, very front of the building that I could wait there until 8:15 when the school opened. And what was the room? The music room. And what was in the music room? Another piano. And what did I play? But by banging it out, and God gave me, for whatever reason, I don't know why, a set of ears that, in addition to being fairly large, I can hear melody and I can figure stuff out. If I hear it, I can kind of, you know, bang it out eventually. And I discovered that all of these songs from the 50s kind of fell on that chord pattern. And then a couple of guys that I grew up with in the neighborhood over in Jersey and I decided that we would form a band kind of like the Sha Na Na group, because number one, it would be fun to put all that grease in our hair and push it back. And number two, the music only required, right? And so we formed this little band called the Lucky Tiger Grease Stick Band, which is, a Lucky Tiger Grease Stick is actually, you know, in the old days in the 60s, you used to get your hair cut in a crew cut, but the barber used to leave like a little bit on the front like that. And then you took the Lucky Tiger Grease Stick and you went, shh. And then that hair would stay up in a hurricane, you know? I mean, you know, like a typhoon could come, yet that little front wouldn't mess up, right? So we were a Lucky Tiger Grease Stick Band, and I discovered in my playing something beautiful about music, which is called harmony. My friend Rosie is here. I think he can demonstrate this if he comes up. Is he there? Oh, there he is. Okay. So I think I left the microphone over there. So harmony is very simple. In addition to what you know that it means about being harmonious, in music it means that one person takes one line and another person takes another line, and you go like the wheels of a car, you know, on an axle. So if you turn, you go this way. If you turn, you go that way. If you go straight, you go ahead. So, for example, let's see. Every song starts this way, by the way. When I want you in my arms, and I want you with all your charms, whenever I want you, all I have to do is dream, 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 dream. When I feel blue in the night and I need you to hold me tight, whenever I want you, all I have to do is dream. By the way, right? Wait.
I can make you mine, taste your lips of wine, anytime, night or day. The only trouble is, gee whiz.
Hear the different lines, I'm down here, he's up there.
I'm dreaming my life away. That is why I love you so, and that is why whenever I want you, all I have to do is dream, 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 dream.
You're a you're a much nicer audience than we had when we were 16 years old, I can tell you that. So, I fell in love with music, and I decided that that's what I was going to do, and I was going to make music for the rest of my life. And I promptly informed my parents, who said to me, as all parents back in those days did, "That's wonderful. You're going to college. Then you can go into music, but you will have something to fall back on." So I went to college, and some of you may know that a pretty interesting thing happened to me while I was in college. I met an old college professor of mine, Morrie Schwartz, and that became something much later in my life. But before any of that happened, I got out of college, and I was headed for my path in music. And I decided that I would go over to Europe with a friend of mine from school. We would backpack around Europe for 5 or 6 weeks, and then I would come home, move to New York, and get my career started in the music business. Well, we backpacked around Europe. That worked out okay. And then when he was leaving, he said, "Hey, I don't have too much money. Can you lend me some money to get home?" And I was going to stay a few more days. And I ended up giving him all the money I had. And then he took off. I had one of those Eurail passes. It turned out that the Eurail pass did not work on the ferry that was supposed to take you to Greece, and I ended up on a train through Yugoslavia, up all the way around for about 3 days to get down to Athens, Greece, missed my connections on my plane ride home, and was stuck in Athens, Greece for 3 days until I could get a plane home. Now, when you get old enough in life, you look back on everything that happens and you see that it happened for some kind of reason. I can tell you at the time that I had no idea that it happened for a reason, but I was at a youth hostel on the lower bunk just passing these 3 days because I had the time until I wanted to go. You know, I had to get to... Is that me? Am I all right? Is there anybody here, or everybody went home? Usually there's some person who looks like they're in charge, but I see nobody. I think Rosie's in charge now. All right, well, we'll just make this up as we go along. So, I'm lying on the bottom bed in this bunk in a youth hostel in the middle of Athens. I couldn't find again if my life depended on it. And a kid up in the upper bunk is reading out loud a newspaper's want ads, an English newspaper in Greece. And he reads out loud, "Hey, this is a cool ad here. It says, wanted piano player for luxury resort on island of Crete. I said, let me see that. He handed it down. Sure enough, piano player wanted for luxury resort on island of Crete. Doesn't say anything else. Has a phone number. So I'm sitting there. I got nothing to do. I figured, yeah, this could be fun. Go for an interview. I won't take the job, but I'll go for an interview. So I call the number, and she says, yes, okay, what time can you get here to talk? I said, what do you want? 2 o'clock. It was like 1 o'clock. I said, okay. Got the address, figured out where it was. I'm wearing cut-off shorts and a T-shirt. I figure, piano player for luxury resort, there's got to be a line out the door, right? I get to this building, nobody. It's just an office. It's not even a stage. It's just an office. So I go, I knock on the door, I go in the office. There's a woman behind a desk, all alone, no piano. She says to me, you're a piano player? I say, yes. Do you drink? I said, do I drink? She said, do you have drinking problem? I said, I don't have a problem. And she said, okay, you go to Crete tonight, and you go audition. And these were in the days where you could actually, I don't know how many of you are old enough to remember this, you could actually write a plane ticket for somebody in Europe if you had, like, an account. And she literally wrote me a plane ticket at the desk. It's great for terrorism, by the way. I'll just write this for myself. Yeah. So she hands me this ticket and says, you know, you got 2 hours to get to the airport. I'm wearing cut-off shorts and a T-shirt. So I jump in a cab. We stop at a department store that I see out the window. I tell the cab to wait. I run into the department store. I grab the first blue suit that I see off the rack that looks like it might fit me. The guy says, oh, wait, I make a bit. I said, I don't have time. He says, okay. He gives me 10 safety pins. And I safety pin up the bottom of the pants and safety pin up the jacket so that it fits. Jump back in the car, fly to Crete. Now I'm figuring, what's the worst that could happen? I land in Crete. I've only been in Athens for a day, let alone I've never been to Crete. Land in Crete, I have a piece of paper that she gave me that I'm supposed to show a cab driver. I walk out, it's pitch black, it's a tiny little island, tiny little airport. See a cab driver, I hand him a thing, he goes, good, come. American, good. This was at a time, by the way, that there were actually countries in the world that liked Americans. And so he was happy to see me. So I get in the car, and he's driving around, and we're on this, like, little rotating island. I see, like, the sea off to the right and the moon reflected in it, but I can't see anything else. It's really dark. And he's driving. He keeps looking over his shoulder, you know, good, America, good, America. We love America. I said, okay, just keep your eyes on the road, you know. And we're driving. All of a sudden, he takes his sharp left turn, and we go into the woods. Now the car is bumping up like that, and I'm seeing trees everywhere, and it's slowing down. I see a bunch of chickens start scattering, you know, as if he's driving through a chicken field, and then he stops the car and turns off the ignition. And I'm just figuring, okay, my obituary will read, former student found cut up with chickens somewhere in Crete. And he points off, there's a little house with a light on, and he is taking me home to show me to his wife, apparently, because he's got an American in the car. So we go into his house. He yells like the Greek equivalent of, honey, I'm home. And guess who I got with me? She comes out, oh. He goes, America, good. She's gone. She brings me in, she's cooking dinner. She's got a big chicken there and everything like that. He says, see. I said, I can't, I gotta go. Okay. She takes the chicken, she takes a watermelon, she takes 3 giant slices of feta cheese, and she gets in the car with us, in the front seat, and she starts feeding me over the back seat. She's handing me chicken legs and wings, and she hands me, and if you've ever had, by the way, watermelon with sliced feta cheese on, it's fantastic. Especially if somebody's feeding it to you over the back of the car. It is not, however, very good if you have a new blue suit on. So by the time we get to the resort, I am covered in chicken grease and watermelon sauce and all the rest of it. And I step out, and all I see is just kind of this big, giant hotel. I don't know where I am. Again, it's pitch black. You can't see any of the sights. And I step inside, and I'm supposed to see a man named Mr. Peter Papadopoulos. So I ask for Peter Papadopoulos, and up comes this kind of squat guy, the older guy, and he's got a drink in his hand. And he says, you the piano player? I said, yeah. He says, go play the piano. It's right over there. And I look, and sure enough, there's like this lounge full of people, all sitting, drinking, smoking. It's about 7:30 at night. And there's a piano sitting in the middle of the room. And he just says, go, play the piano. Now, remember, I have no sheet music. I have nothing. I got grease stains on my suit. I got nothing with me. So I do what any piano player worth his salt, thrown in the same situation, would do. I sit down with no sheet music. Every song begins this way, by the way. And I play. Finish Misty, and that's it. Anybody can play Misty. Now I'm out of Misty, and for the next hour, I play derivatives of Misty. The slow Misty, the fast Misty, anything else I can think of. So I finish the song. I'm finished there, and I see him watching me, and he keeps drinking, and people keep coming over and giving him drinks. I'm thinking, man, this guy can hold a lot of liquor. And he comes over to me after about an hour. He says, all right, come with me. We go down to this nightclub, little taberna, down at the bottom of a hill. And he sits down and he buys me something to eat. And it turns out it's his birthday. And apparently in Crete, when it's your birthday, everybody is supposed to buy you a drink and you are not allowed to refuse. So by this point, this guy is long in the bag. And the band is playing. There's this Greek oompa band, you know, like, like that. So they're playing, and at one point he says to me, do you sing? And I said, well, you know, I sing a little bit. Go sing with the band. I said, I can't sing with that band. He says, sing with the band if you want the job. Okay, figure. So I go up there. Somebody translates for me. The band, the guy at the piano, he's got like a cigarette dangling from his lips like this, and he leans over. His name was Dino, I remember. He goes, that. Elvis Presley? And I said, okay, Elvis Presley, you know. He goes, blue suede shoes? I said, okay, blue suede shoes, that's fine. And then we had to decide what key we were going to sing it in, but of course, the Greek alphabet is not the same as the American alphabet. So he says, do, re, mi. Fa, so, la, and I said, la, la, that'll be good, la, la, okay. So we're going to sing Blue Suede Shoes in la, and now the lights are all off, and those of you who know that song by Elvis Presley, it's, you know, it starts cold. There's no musical, there's no, there's none of that. So all of a sudden, out of the blue, he goes, you know, what? Four. And I start singing one for the money, two for the shit like that, and everybody's forks drop and everybody goes. And suddenly I had that out-of-body experience that you sometimes have in life where you kind of float out of yourself, you look back down on the most ridiculous situation, and you say to your outer self, inner self, what's the worst that could happen? I'll never be here again. No one will ever tell this story to anybody. Have a good time. So I decide I'm going to do the best Elvis Presley that I know. And I start shaking around the place. I'm dancing at the tables. I'm swinging back and forth. By the time I'm done, I get a standing ovation, probably because they just thought I was a lunatic and they better clap for me because I might do something really crazy. I go back to the table with Peter Papadopoulos and he says, that's it. I'm hiring you as my singer and as my piano player. And I thought, yeah, I don't really think I'm going to take a job as your singer, your piano player. And then he said, and I'll give you $300 American cash a week and your own room. And I said, I can do that. So the next morning, at the crack of dawn, I went back to the airport. I still had not seen what this place looked like. It was dark when I left and dark when I got up. I fly back to Athens. I grab my stuff from the youth hostel. I actually get the suit fixed instead of the safety pins. And I stop at the train station, which is where you made phone calls in Europe back in those days. And I call my mom and dad and I say, listen, good news is, got a job. Bad news is, it's in Crete. I'm not coming home. And I flew that afternoon. I actually started singing and playing that night. And for the next 6.5 months, I had a job where all I had to do was play 1 hour of lounge piano and sing a half hour with the band of just Elvis songs and Ray Charles songs. and whatever I wanted to sing. And this was so remote. This was in a little fishing village called Agios de Galaos, which is now quite the resort, but back in 1979, nobody had discovered it, that I honestly think many of the people who came to hear me thought I had invented these songs, you know? And I became sort of a little king of the island on that little corner. I could stand on a street corner and just, you know, look out, and a car would stop and go, Elvis, come in, come in, come in, you know? And I'd get in the car and they'd drive me home, whatever. And I have my own bungalow on the Aegean Sea, and I got 3 meals a day, and I had the best suntan you'll ever have in your life. I swam all day. I rode bikes up in the mountains. I, you know, flirted with the guests and all the rest of it. And all I had to do was play this thing. And after six and a half months, I quit that job to come home to New York because I felt I needed to start my career as a serious musician in New York City. And I proceeded to fail miserably to audition at every place and get turned down, to bring songs to record companies and have them say, nah, I don't hear it, and to form bands with some guys who were old enough to say, if I ever, ever get the chance to, like, get a job on a luxury island at a resort, that's where I'm gonna go instead. And I kept my mouth shut about what I had walked away from. Well, after several years of doing this, music and getting nowhere, during the day, my time was somewhat free because I worked at night. I played all kinds of dive bars and you name it. And I happened to be in a supermarket, and I picked up a newspaper that they were handing out. It was called the Flushing Tribune in Flushing, Queens. And, you know, it was free. And at the bottom of the paper, it said, if you have spare time, we could use some help writing and taking pictures and stuff. So I figured, well, I've got some spare time, never tried anything like that. So I went down to their offices. I was the youngest person by about 85 years. And they said, well, we'll give you an assignment. We'll try you out. And they gave me an assignment to write a story about parking meters. There was a meeting that night, and they were going to raise the price of the parking meters from 5 cents to 10 cents. And they said, go and write a story about that and bring it back. Now, all I knew about journalism or writing to that point was I had seen the movie All the President's Men. So I thought, well, okay, you know, everybody in that movie, they had like a little notepad and a little pen, and they asked very aggressive questions. So I got a notepad, I got a pen, and I went to this meeting. I said, why are you raising the parking rates? And I wrote down what they said, and then I went home and I typed it up. And really, I based everything off of things that I had read my whole life, you know. So I said, well, the first paragraph in a newspaper is usually like the facts, you know, the who, what, where, when, and then they usually have a quote. So I made up a quote. Well, I didn't make it up. I used one of the quotes. And then I came back in and another paragraph, and I wrote it, and I gave it to them. So the next week, I go to the supermarket, and I pick up the newspaper, and at the bottom of the front page is the story about parking meters going from 5 cents to 10 cents. And there's my name, and there's a bunch of words. And this proved two things. One, absolutely nothing happened that week in Flushing, Queens. Two, you can fall in love with an art in an instant. And seeing my name and seeing those words next to my name gave me a sense of creative satisfaction that I had only had before with that. And a voice inside me said, you know, maybe you want to do this. Maybe you take that creative talent and you put it over into that. And you try doing that. And that's what I did. And I have basically been a writer ever since. So the music part of my life basically died there, somewhere up there. And I sort of put it aside. And I've always been interested in music, and I've met a lot of musicians. I've become friendly with musicians over the years, but I never wrote about it. It was as if those two things should never mix. And finally, after a number of years, I began to notice that people would say to me, I read that book, you know, Tuesdays with Morrie, and it changed my life. And I have to say, the first 100 times I heard that, I think inside, I was always gracious about it, but I think inside I said, come on, it's a book. How does a book change your life? But as I began to hear it and began to hear the stories more and more, I realized that they were very sincere in what they said, and that the words that I had written somehow the story I had told had affected them in a way that it changed their path. And I began to think about how everybody probably has that ability in some way or another, given whatever talent they had. And I began to form an idea about, well, what if there was a musician who was so talented and had such a gift that he could actually change lives? Not the, oh, you changed my life verbal thing, but actually changed a life. And I created this legend of this mythical guitar player named Frankie Presto, who you saw some of my music friends talking about as if he really existed. And by the way, Burt Bacharach actually cried during our interview, saying, oh man, I miss him. I miss Frankie. I miss him. And I said, Burt, he wasn't real. You can. But in the book, he is so gifted that he actually can change people's lives with this guitar that he gets when he's 9 years old, that when he plays it, in certain situations, a string will turn blue, and when the string turns blue, another person's life is changed. And then the string evaporates and it's used up. And so he gets these six chances in life to change six lives. And it became this really interesting concept to me and got bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And what I'd like to do before I wrap up, if it's all right with you, is just read a couple little pieces of the book to you that sort of illustrate where the story goes. Is that all right? I don't want to bore you. So. And the first page will tell you, and this is the very first page of the book, will tell you all you need to know in terms of who narrates the book and how it's sort of a unique voice right from the start. So this is literally the first page of the book. I have come to claim my prize. He is there, inside the coffin. In truth, he is mine already. But a good musician holds respectfully until the final notes are played. This man's melody is finished, but his mourners have come a great distance to add a few stanzas. Let us listen. Heaven can wait. Do I frighten you? I shouldn't. I am not death, a grim reaper in a hood reeking of decay, as your young people say, please. Nor am I the great judge whom you all fear in the end. Who am I to judge a life? I have been with the bad and the good. I hold no verdict on the wrongs this man committed, nor do I measure his virtues. I do know a great deal about him, the spells he wove with his guitar, the crowds he enthralled with that deep, breathy voice, the lives he changed with his six blue strings. I could share all of this, or I could rest. I always make time to rest. Do you think me coy? I am at some times. I'm also sweet and calming and dissonant and angry and difficult and simple, as soothing as poured sand, as piercing as a pinprick. I am music, and I am here for the soul of Frankie Presto. Not all of it, just the rather large part he took from me when he came into this world. However well used, I am a loan, not a possession. You give me back upon departure. I will gather up Frankie's talent to spread on newborn souls, and I will do the same with yours one day. There is a reason you glance up when you first hear a melody or tap your foot to the sound of a drum. All humans are musical. Why else would the Lord give you a beating heart? So that's a little section one of, oh, thank you. So we discover that music is going to tell us the story of its beloved child. And it turns out that in this book, and the conceit is that when you are born, when you come out of the womb, before you can see, before your eyes actually open for the first time as a baby, you can actually see, you just don't remember it. And what you see is a wall of bright, brilliant colors. And when your fists clench for the first time as an infant, what you're actually doing is clenching the colors that are most appealing to you. And each of those colors is a talent. And so you clench what sort of is meant for you as your talent. And that's the talent that you have for the rest of your life. So when you say, well, how's that good? These kids, this kid's so good at drawing. He's so good at math. He's such a dancer. You should hear his voice. Why does somebody get one talent or the other? Because that's what you grab when you first came into the world. And in Frankie's case, he grabbed two big fistfuls of music. He took more music than anybody else in history. And as a result, he has this sort of special life. Now, he has a tragic early life. His mother dies the night that he's born in Spain in a burning church, which actually happened. In fact, everything in the book except Frankie is actually real. Everything. But he's like Zelig or Forrest Gump. He's there for all of it, but he didn't exist. And the church burns to the ground by angry militia people who are killing priests and nuns. And his mother is killed in the process. But the last thing she does before she dies is hum a melody into her newborn baby's ear called Lagrima, a beautiful song by Francisco Torrego, who was really the father of modern classical guitar and Spaniard. And then she dies, and he's taken care of by a nun who rescues him, and then he winds up thrown in a river, and he's about to die floating down the river, and a dog saves him and pulls him out, and then a sardine maker raises him for a while, and then eventually other people. And there's a point to this, which I'll get to. But I will, I promise. The sardine maker, however, realizes that his young child, now 5 years old, has bad eyes. And he's always rubbing his eyes from the incident in the water. And he's afraid that one day he's going to go blind. And he worries, how is he going to take care of himself if he's going to go blind? And he remembers that he once saw a blind guitar player and realized that's what you can do. If you're blind, you can still play music, and therefore he might be able to have a future. So he determines he wants to take his child to this blind guitar player to get lessons. Unfortunately, this blind guitar player no longer plays. He's rumored to be a drunk and a recluse who nobody, you know, bothers with. But he finds out where he lives, and he takes his son, Francisco, to the guitar player's apartment. The next day was Sunday. After attending morning mass, Bafa, that's the sardine maker, took the boy and his hairless dog to the Crystal Senegal Street, hoping to catch the guitar player in a good mood. Even a drunk, Bafa reasoned, might give Sunday to God. He found the laundry, and above it he saw faded blue shutters latched shut. The bell button was covered with a long piece of masking tape, so the three of them had no choice but to walk up the steps. It was a hot day, and Bafa, still in his church suit, was dripping sweat when they reached the landing. He wiped his face with a handkerchief, then knocked. Nothing. He knocked again. Nothing. Bafa shrugged at Frankie, who stepped up and banged with his small fist, two at a time, as if playing a conga drum. Si, que pasa? Came a voice. It was gravelly and loose, as if still waking up. Señor, Bafa said, I would like to speak to you about teaching.
Teaching what?
Guitar.
Go away.
It is important.
Go away.
I will pay you.
Teaching who?
My child.
Girl or boy?
Boy.
Girls are better students.
He is a boy.
How old?
Bafa paused. 7. Frankie looked up. Small for his age.
No boys.
He is very talented.
No boys.
He is very talented.
So am I.
I would pay you.
Of course you would pay me.
So you'll teach him?
No.
Señor.
Go away.
Bafa turned to Frankie. Sing something, he whispered. Frankie shook his head. Sing something, Bafa repeated. Now, most children will not sing when asked. At the early ages, talent yields to fear, sometimes at the later ages, too. But this moment, I knew, was too important in the overall map of Frankie's life. So I, music, gave the child another nudge. Da, 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 he began slowly. Bafa raised his eyes. He had never heard this tune. Da, 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 the boy continued. It was a simple melody, childish but haunting. It went high and then came down on the major notes, like something you might hear played on a xylophone. Da, 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 da. Frankie stopped. What song is that? Bafa asked. Suddenly, the door opened wide. A tall man with dark sunglasses, thick stubble, unkempt dark hair, and a sleeveless undershirt with a large coffee stain over the belly was gripping the doorframe like a guard.
"It is called Lagrima," he said, "by Francisco Torrega."
He lowered his chin in the direction of the boy.
"He does not sound seven."
All right, so that's that. Thank you. Thank you. The last thing I'm going to read you is one of the interesting conceits of the book. Frankie goes on and he grows older and he eventually is raised by that blind guitar player, and then the blind guitar player, something happens to him, and he has to put Frankie on a boat going to America, and it gets hijacked, and he ends up in London, and then Django Reinhardt, the gypsy guitar player, finds him as a beggar on the street, and he takes him to America, and then in America, he leaves him behind, and he's raised by nuns, and I will explain why all of this happens. And along the way, as I say, he's sort of like Zelig, and so he's there for all kinds of things. He's in Duke Ellington's band. He influences Hank Williams. He's in a studio with a guy named Richard Pennyman, who's having a really hard time finding his sound, and he says to him, "That song, Tutti Frutti, that's a good one. I think you should do that one." And 15 minutes later, Little Richard is born. All real stories, real incidents, and all the rest of it. And at one point, he's about 20 years old, and he's playing guitar as a backup musician to a singer named Elvis Presley. And throughout the book, I have some of my musician friends, some of whom you saw on the screen, actually appear in the book for a few pages as mourners at his funeral. And they tell different stories about when they were with Frankie here, there. So you saw some of them when Marsalis found him in a monastery with his head shaved, playing guitar. And Paul Stanley saw him come in and audition for Kiss, which we find out that the only reason he auditioned for Kiss is that he had an 8-year-old daughter at the time, and she wanted him to be in Kiss. And when Frankie found out they didn't wear makeup anymore, he wasn't interested in it anymore. So this is an indicative section of those kind of voices with a former member of the Jordanaires. Do you know who the Jordanaires were? They were Elvis's backup group. And he tells a story about this night that Frankie was with Elvis Presley. This will be the last thing I read for you to give you an idea of sort of the adventures of the book. And I'll do my best to put on a Nashville accent or whatever this is. Met him. "Well, you ready for this? I met Frankie with Elvis Presley on a Louisiana hayride, 1957. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Well, hell yeah, it's a true story. I don't mind saying it now. I was supposed to keep quiet till the day Elvis died and the day Frankie died. But they're both gone now, and I'm 82 years old. What am I waiting for? You want to know? I'll tell you. This is what happened. I was singing those days with the Jordanaires, which was Elvis's backup group. Now, Frankie was playing guitar. He looked a lot like Elvis, there's no denying that. They both had them toothy smiles and all that hair, real dark. But in those days, nobody knew Frankie could do nothing except play the guitar. I'm not even sure how he got to Louisiana. Someone said he came from Detroit in the trunk of a car. Seriously. But he kept to himself and didn't smoke or carouse, and if you don't do that in a band, well, there ain't hardly time to get to know you. So anyhow, this one afternoon, we're at the Shreveport Municipal Auditorium, and we're doing our sound check for that night's show, and Elvis was out with a girl somewhere doing who knows what. And Colonel Parker, Elvis's manager, was so angry, he was ready to jerk a knot in someone's tail. Colonel ran a tight ship, see, and he hated anyone being late, even Elvis. So we waited 5 minutes, 10 minutes, he kept looking at his watch, and finally he screamed, "Play something, let's get going." Well, you didn't cross the colonel, no sir. So the band just started into the show's first number, "I Want You, I Need You, I Love You." And the Jordanaires did our background parts, but of course, without Elvis, it sounds kind of stupid. Just a lot of woo. And you can feel the colonel's anger from 100 feet away. His face is getting all red. He keeps looking at the doors and pacing back and forth. And suddenly, we hear a voice singing the words. And it sounds like Elvis, except it's Frankie up there on the mic. And he's singing it perfect. And I look at the other guys thinking, the colonel is going to string this kid up. Imitating Elvis in front of the boss? I mean, you just don't do something like that.
Now the Colonel stares real hard and pushes his jaw out and he bites on that cigar he always had in his mouth. And I'm thinking, nice working with you, Frankie. But the Colonel doesn't stop him. We finish the song and all he says to the sound guy is, are we done here? So we walk off the stage kind of shaking our heads, and I remember Hoot, the piano player, he handed Frankie a beer right after that. And when Frankie asked him what for, Hoot said, 'cause you're still in one piece. So, okay, flash ahead now. About a month later, we're on a tour of the Pacific Northwest with Elvis, and we're booked to play in Vancouver, Canada, in a football stadium. And we come to find out that Colonel Parker's talking to the Army about Elvis getting drafted. The Army wanted Elvis to start his service, and the Colonel is desperate to get him to delay till he could get more recordings into the can. He's got a million-dollar tiger by the tail, and he'll be doggone if anybody, even the United States government, is going to take it away. So the Army agrees to meet with Elvis and the Colonel, but it's a secret meeting, and it's in Virginia on the same day we're supposed to play in Vancouver, and they're not budging. Now, most people would have just canceled the show, but most people ain't Colonel Parker. He didn't want to give up the gate from a football stadium, not for nobody. So the night before, we're up there in Vancouver, and me and the fellas get called by the Colonel to come down to a little theater at midnight. It's empty. No sign of Elvis, just a stage with all our equipment set up. And the Colonel's already there, and he's talking to guess who? Frankie. And he's whispering, and Frankie's nodding his head. And finally, the Colonel turns to us and says, I want y'all to run through the show with the boy singing. And we look at each other like, what? But we don't say nothing. We do as we're told. We play, Frankie sings. And sure as I'm standing here, by the end of that rehearsal, if I shut my eyes, I couldn't tell if I was listening to Frankie or Elvis. That boy was so musical, he could have made a kick drum sound like a nightingale. Know what I mean? Still, we're wondering, how's this going to work? He looks like Elvis, but he ain't Elvis, you know. But when we're finished, Colonel Parker says, now listen here, the boy's going to stand way back by you. He's not going to come to the front of the stage, you hear me? And no talking in between the numbers. Y'all just go from one song into the next. Well, the next night comes, real Elvis is somewhere in Virginia with the U.S. government, and we're in at Vancouver, Canada, in a black sedan pulling up to the stadium. Frankie's in the back, sitting between us, dressed in that gold satin jacket, wearing sunglasses, being real still. I couldn't tell if he was super relaxed or scared to death. I was scared to death, I can tell you that. But when we go out there, we take the stage, and we look at the fans, and they're so far away, up in the stands, and there are these sawhorses out on the field that the Colonel set up, telling everybody they were there for Elvis's safety. So we got us a good 40-yard cushion. Nobody's getting close, which is just how the Colonel wanted it. I whispered to Bill, one of the other singers, what do you reckon? And he said, Clem, if it goes bad, run to the right. That's where the cars are. And then the announcer yells, ladies and gentlemen, Elvis Presley. And the place becomes one big scream, and out steps Frankie, wearing that gold jacket and a black shirt, and guitar around his neck, high up on the straps, the way Elvis wore it. Well, I braced myself for something, people booing or throwing stuff, but never happened. They believed it, 100%. And Frankie stayed back with us like the Colonel told him, didn't go out front where the cameras could catch him. And he just started right in with, well, since my baby left me, you know, from Heartbreak Hotel. And from that point, it might not have mattered if Frankie, me, or Pearl Bailey was singing. It got so crazy you could barely hear a thing. And suddenly all them kids come running out of the stands and out onto the field, and Frankie tears into I Got a Woman and Rip It Up and Ready Teddy, and we're looking at each other and we're smiling like bandits because he's good and we're getting away with it. And the police are chasing the kids back up in the stands, but then they come running back onto the field again. And with each song, Frankie's getting more and more into it, you know, doing some of Elvis's leg shakes and the way he thrust his hips. And a couple times I shook my head at Frankie like, don't do it, man, just lay back. Let's get out of here safe. But then comes Hound Dog, and I guess he couldn't help it. He just cuts loose. He pops out front, and he's shaking and windmilling his arms, and he's got that sneer on his lips just like Elvis had, and that did it. Crowd mobbed the field, all of them. The police is trying to hold them back. Whistles are shrieking, and people are getting knocked over. And once Hound Dog was done, security hustles us off the stage, Frankie grinning and waving at the crowd like, bye-bye, see ya. 22 minutes.
That was the whole show. 22 minutes. We pulled it off. To this day, people talk about that concert as one of the wildest and craziest of Elvis's career. And the last one ever in Canada. And only the band, the Jordanaires, the Colonel, and Elvis's own self, God rest his soul, knew what went on. And Frankie, of course. He left the band the next day. I don't think he wanted to face Elvis. Maybe Elvis didn't want to face him. Either way, he was gone, and I didn't see him again until years later. By then, he was kind of different, more confident, more like a star, you know? I think that concert changed him. He had a taste of it, and he wanted it for himself. Nobody said nothing about that night for damn near 60 years. But I'm 82 now, and Frankie's dead, so to hell with it. He deserves a credit. You think about all them people who became Elvis impersonators, made whole careers out of it. But Frankie was the first, and you gotta say the best. I mean, if the point is to make people feel like they're really seeing the king, he's the only one who ever really pulled it off. Well, that's that. The point of the story, outside of hopefully being very entertaining, is that while Frankie has this magic guitar and the strings turn blue and he influences these people, the truth of the matter is that everybody has six blue strings or 12 blue strings or 10, or 4, whatever. Everybody has a chance to change somebody's life with their talent. You know, people have said to me, as I told you, the book changed my life. If you go into the hospital and you're taken care of by a particularly caring nurse or doctor, and when you get better, you say, you know what? That's what I want to do. Then their talent changed your life. A teacher inspires you to say, you know, I want to teach. It made such an impression on me. That teacher changed your life. If you're good at cooking, if you're good at piano playing, every musician I've ever met always had someone early in their life who they heard playing and they said, I want to sound like that. And that person's talent changed their life. Everybody is given it, and the key is just sort of find the talent that we were meant to have, the color that we grabbed when we came out of the womb, and be satisfied with the fact that that's your gift, that's your talent, and that's how you can affect other people. I always thought mine was going to be over there. Turned out it was more over here. I ended up making a soundtrack album for this song, and 35 years later, 35 years after I tried to make it in the music business, there's a song in a book that I write about called No No Honey, and it's a long story that I'll save you the trouble for, but we were getting artists to record songs that were actually in the book. And real artists who participated in those videos, they wanted to actually make songs out of the fake songs that were in the book. And so they took the lyrics and they took the title and then they created music and then they recorded the songs. So they were actually remaking songs that never existed. And one of the songs was supposed to go to this woman named Ingrid Michaelson, and at the last minute she changed her mind and did a different one, thus leaving this song untouched, and I had 2 days to find somebody to do the song and to write the song, and that's a little hard. So I actually sat down at the piano, and the song's called No No Honey, and it was supposed to be a fun, upbeat kind of song, and when I was writing it in the book, I had this idea in my head that what the chorus would go like. And I said, well, it'd be like, you know, no, no, honey, no, no, honey, and then there'd be like a chorus of background singers or something like that. Hold on, hold on, hold on, hold on. Wait, 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 wait. Stop, stop, stop. Not yet. Wow. Hold on. So, I had this idea for the words, and then I started to hear this little line in my head. Just a simple, like, you know. So I took that line, I took the idea of no, no, honey, and some background singers. I called up a bunch of people, and 24 hours later, they were all in the studio, and without talking, and this is the beauty of music, without talking, I just said, well, I'm kind of hearing it kind of, it's like a, I'm kind of like that. It's going, no, no, honey, no, no, hear that, too. No, no, okay, 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 we do that, whatever. And oh, by the way, it's got this, you know. And about an hour and a half later, this is what we had. Now you can hit it. Ready? So 35 years after the fact, I finally got to make a record that you can now get in stores at Amazon or iTunes or whatever. So I've come full circle.